G'day everyone. My name's Daniel Hill. I've been invited to speak today on one of the regular topics that the Catholic Society has, today is the Crusades. Myself, I studied the First Crusade particularly and did a thesis on it. I'm an on-again, off-again PhD student in medieval history, and I work with the Catholic Archdiocese of Sydney as well. I'll get into it straight away so we have time for discussion afterwards on this very windy, wet day. The question is, the Crusades a Catholic atrocity, or were the Crusades a Catholic atrocity? Very plainly, the answer is, in my opinion, no. I'll be working, speaking mainly on the First Crusade for two reasons. One, it's good to start with the start. What's the original impetus for this kind of movement? And two, it kind of, on that note, it gives a sense of why did the Crusades happen? Where did they come from? What was the historical context from which they came? But another part of the answer was it a Catholic atrocity is, well, war is atrocious. And while it's fun to study for some people historically, while it has an impact on all our lives, because history impacts all our lives, war is not something that anybody in their right mind would want. It's not something anyone in their right mind would think is the pinnacle of human life and existence. At the same time, people do very wonderful and heroic things during war as well, and it's that great paradox. As well, there's many atrocities that happen during war, and we're not just talking about, you know, basic military procedures and activities, but by its nature, atrocious things can happen, and the worst in humans can also come out. So that's a long-winded answer, but I'm going to look at particularly the Crusades, what led up to the Crusades, what their fundamental impetus was. We need to place the Crusades in their historical context. Now, many of you may know this, but I'll go over it anyway because it's very important. Hopefully you can see it. It's a bit fuzzy, but it's a very simple map, which is helpful. So the Crusades happen mainly around the Mediterranean, and they have a lot to do with Europe and the Middle East, Asia Minor, Palestine, etc. Essentially, that area which was the former Roman Empire. And by 450, the Roman Empire had split in half. There was an Eastern Roman Empire, which became the Byzantine Empire, and the Western Roman Empire. You had the Persians as well, who were very powerful at the time. At this time, you also have the invasion of the Huns, which dissipates. But you have the Western Roman Empire is very clearly diminishing as an empire, and becomes the victim of the barbarian invasions, as we call them. You can see, you got the Vandals here already. You got the Visigoths here. Now, what does that say? I should know who that is, but the Suevic, who are another type of Goth, and the Western Roman Empire becomes the beginnings of the medieval world, and the countries that we know today, France, England, Poland, Germany, etc., etc. The Eastern Roman Empire, of course, continues on much, much further. Okay, so the First Crusade begins in 1095, but it wouldn't have happened without something happening over in Arabia, which is the beginnings of Islam. The Crusades being, of course, a battle essentially between Christian Westerners and groups of Islamic people. You can see the purple is the Byzantine Empire, which took and started looking after parts of the old Western Roman Empire, but it's the last major civilization left of that size and scale. In not too long, you can see how far the Islamic conquest spread. And they take over a large part of what used to be the Roman Empire, used to be the Byzantine Empire, and start spreading across North Africa. This is 670 AD, so it's not too long from the beginning, very, very fast. And you can see that, in fact, Islam spreads right up to Spain, and in fact, the Islamic incursions go right up close to Paris. So that's kind of the extent to which the invasion occurred. And it's worthwhile looking at the preemptors of the Crusades throughout history. So the conquest of Jerusalem, Jerusalem being part of a Christian civilization at the time. And then you've got the conquest of the Iberian Peninsula, which is the Spanish Peninsula. The Battle of Covadonga, I might pronounce that wrong, was the first battle in Spain that defeated the Islamic armies. The Battle of Tours is very famous. It's the one that stopped them in France. So the Islamic armies never went any further than that into Europe. But you also have the Mediterranean, which allows people to move around a lot because of ships. So you have a lot of Islamic conquests in the Mediterranean, particularly Sicily, which gives access to Italy. So you have, due to that, the sack of St. Peter's Basilica in Rome in 846 AD. But then we shift over to where the Crusades happened, which is in Asia Minor around Constantinople. And that vast area of Palestine had been completely almost conquered by the Muslim armies, and completely by surprise. They had no idea that this was on the horizon, and how fast it happened is phenomenal. The areas that they conquered were also often in play by the Persian Empire. The Persian Empire pretty much finally dissolves into a forgotten speck of history. An enormous empire over many centuries disappears, and we have the Battle of Manzikert in 1071 AD, where the Byzantine army is defeated, utterly defeated by the Turks. Now, the Turks were a people that had become Muslim and had begun conquering in that area. So Constantinople, which is which is now Istanbul, is vulnerable. The Byzantine Empire is completely and utterly vulnerable. And you can see here, this is Manzikert, you can see here how they're constantly going right up to the city of Constantinople. So I'll leave it there. So what's the feeling at the time in Europe? The feeling is that there's constant pressure and constant attack. It's very clear that there's no desire to just by the Islamic armies, which are divided into different groups themselves by this time, but there's no desire for Islamic armies to sit back and relax. They want to conquer Europe. Rome is a particularly important place for them to take, and Constantinople is in its way. So to get to Rome, you have to come up here, or you have to come through Constantinople. So the Emperor of Constantinople, over a period of time, sent requests for help to the kings and queens and lords and nobles of Europe, and particularly to the Pope. And eventually, after a period of time, after many attempts to do so, they send what's known as the crusading movement. Now, the word crusade was not what they used. They used the word pilgrimage. It wasn't for about 200 years they started to use the word crusade, which means taking the cross, which is the sign of becoming that kind of pilgrim. So here we have the world just before the calling of the crusade, the first crusade. Essentially, the green parts, down the bottom at least, are the Islamic controlled areas. You've got the Seljuks, who are the Turks, and you've got the Fatimids, who are the Egyptian Muslims. And then there's the rest of Europe. The Byzantine Empire, you can see, has shrunk. It's quite small. It's lost pretty much all of its holdings in the Middle East and North Africa. Now, we move over to, I might skip this point, but we move over to the idea of the Crusade. Now, it comes down to a number of different ideas that we get from Christian theology, from the Bible, etc., etc., but it's fundamentally grounded in the notion of love of neighbour. Because what I've just gone through is a couple of maps moving around and very quickly said this empire and that empire. But these empires are full of people who believe certain things, who have been there for a long time, who have civilization that they hold to and believe and wish to defend. And they're predominantly Christian at this time. And they're calling out for help. That's the fundamental idea. And you have... in Europe at the time, a rise in the whole notion of the knight and a soldier as being a person who's meant to defend and look after other people. Because, you know, soldiers by their nature can be a little bit aggressive. So you have a movement to do good things like that. Now... I can read that out to you. It's not good to read your slides out. It's pretty boring, but I'll do it anyway. An act of charity in defence of Christ's body, whether manifest in Christian individuals, Christian states or peoples, or church institutions, in union with the perceived will of Christ. Now, that's just a little easy get-out-of-jail-free card in the sense that, in the end, we all, you know, Christ doesn't appear to anybody if you're a Christian. He doesn't appear to you very often and say to you, you will go and do this. It's a part of our own free will to understand what we're meant to do. But that's the fundamental understanding of Crusades. Now, this is my definition, by the way. Now, we call this an armed pilgrimage. And it's very important to understand why, because a pilgrimage was a peaceful religious observance. And Christians still go on pilgrimage today. But why would a pilgrimage be armed? Because the pilgrims going to these places were being attacked. So the idea was you wouldn't necessarily separate, you know, the whole idea was that you weren't just going to war, but you were going to Jerusalem, a very important place that they felt needed to be liberated, on pilgrimage, and at the same time defending yourself in a very militaristic and formal way with weapons. There's also the whole notion of unification with the Eastern Church. At this time, the Eastern Church and the Western Church had split over an argument, which we won't go into. But when the papacy, when the Pope, who very powerful, obviously, in Europe at the time, sees an opportunity to assist brethren in the East, that fuels the idea of going on crusade. And then there's 4 points as well down there, which are all about constant reform in the church that is going on at the time. I referred to the whole notion of the local nobles and knights not necessarily looking at fighting each other, but using their skills to defend the innocent. And that's both internally and within Europe at the time, which had just come out of this kind of turmoil of the fall of the Roman Empire, and also those on the outskirts, those under attack. Now, and it was also focused to those in Spain, because as you might have noticed, Spain was a frontier. And in fact, the Pope said to the Spanish, you know, don't you go on crusade to Jerusalem, we need you to stay in Spain to defend that frontier. Now, in regards to, okay, well, what did they say? What did the Pope say? This is essentially the only historical historically verifiable, unbiased line we have about the Pope's idea for the crusade. Whoever for devotion alone, not to obtain honour or money, shall set out to free the Church of God at Jerusalem, that shall be counted to him for all penance. So we see from the very beginning that the idea was, it was a religious observant to free the Church of God at Jerusalem. In other words, to free both the church, the building, but also the Christian people who had been conquered. And that shall be counted to him for all penance. So it's a religious, spiritual endeavour. And it very clearly says it's not a secular endeavour. Now, in this period, whether you can separate the two entirely is up for grabs. But the idea, the impetus is not for you to go and gain money and wealth. And we'll find out a bit more about that. What I'll do now is quickly go through the story of the First Crusade, but I don't want to take up too much of our time on that. I will just go through some of the characters. Urban II was the Pope, Blessed Urban II. Adhemar of Le Puy was his legate, so who was a bishop who was sent to represent him and lead the army on his behalf. We have Alexius Comnenus, who was the Byzantine emperor, one of the emperors who asked for help. He had a general, Tacticus. And then you have the Turks and the Fatimids, which are the two Islamic groups that the Crusaders encounter, the Turks being the ones close to Constantinople, the Fatimids the ones, they were in control of Jerusalem at the time. We have a variety of nobility here. Interestingly, these two fellows are an example of perhaps a bit more naughty type of crusader, to put it that way. They're the ones who may have gone for wealth and power. And both of those were Vikings originally. Now, they're Normans, but let's call them what they were. They were Vikings originally. Some of the others would have had Viking blood too, but very clearly, Bohemond of Taranto and Tancred were had a history fighting the Byzantine Empire before they decided to join the Crusade. And they're very good soldiers, though. Now, I'll just to give you a bit of context, a bit of military history. There's some understanding of what was going on. The guy in the middle is getting a bit excited, but and he's a little bit later, maybe 100 years later. But it's very similar. So that's a kind of how a crusader would have been dressed. There's a Byzantine soldier on the right, and there's an excited crusader in the middle. And there's a few more examples of the Byzantine and Western crusader. The crusaders, of course, were knights mostly, and their great power was the lance on the horseback, which was a very phenomenal weapon, military tactic, when it was used effectively. And then we have, here's an example of Turks. They were very much a horse archer type of army. So very different type of military tactics. And there's an example of that. So they're very hard to defeat as a crusader, a Turk is very hard to defeat if you didn't have a horse, because they would run in and out with their bows and fire at them. And these are the Fatimids, which were a little bit more heavily armed than the Turks, just for your interest's sake. Okay, so the First Crusade is called, and this is the route they take. They come from all over Europe. They go through Constantinople. That's a very important meeting, because Constantinople is used to being besieged and doesn't want armies of whatever stripe in its city or near its city. The very nature of the armies are enormous things that need to be fed. They're hard to control, no matter what intention there is. And so they quickly ship them across the Bosphorus, just here, this strait, into to lay siege to Nicaea, which was the closest city that was under the control of the Turks, which they conquer. Nicaea surrenders, however, to the Byzantines. And there's a bit of historical debate about this, but it seems very clear that the Crusaders were meant to join with a Byzantine army and help re-establish Byzantine control in the Middle East. It doesn't work, But that was that's the fundamental idea. So it once again had a very specific aim. Now there are some debate about that, but new research has made it pretty clear that that's undisputable. They then have a battle in Dorylaeum, which is interesting, and that's where the Crusaders are split in two, and one Crusader group gets attacked by horse archers and they can't really defend themselves very well. It's in the desert, so they pitch their tents to stop the arrows being able to get through, and then the other Crusader army comes and rescues them. But it's quite a story, that one. Then they get to Antioch, if you can see that on the map over there, and that's an enormous undertaking, a siege that goes over a number of years. It's a very, very big ancient city. It has a river from the Mediterranean. It controls a large area. And it's phenomenal that the Crusaders won this this siege. They besieged the city, and they're eventually let into the city, it seems, by a Maronite who opened a back door. Some of the sources say an Arab Muslim who from the city, some say a Maronite. A lot of people don't know the difference, I do. But and then they are besieged themselves by an army, a Muslim army, a Turkish army. And without many horses, they charge out of the city, and for whatever reason, that the Turkish army is defeated, which is still a mystery to historians as to how they won that, particularly without horses. And then we get to the siege of Jerusalem in 1099, the penultimate moment in the Crusades, and it's both a great victory, but also there's a great massacre. It's often spoke about that the Crusaders, once eventually getting into the city, kind of let loose. Now we can talk about this a bit more later if we have time. But yes, pardon. That's right. Raymond's troops did not participate. Thank you. So there were. Anyway, we can talk about that later. I need to get through the whole story, to be honest. But yes, here's an example of the kind of siege engines they used to get into Jerusalem, which was normal at the time. And then the Crusaders set up a number of states. So they divide the area into territories for them to look after. Now, what's interesting at the siege of Antioch, which I forgot to tell you, unfortunately, was at the siege of Antioch, something happens that changes the history of the Middle East, of Western civilization. Perhaps if you want to go that far, is that they had conquered the city of Antioch, the Crusaders. There was a general with them, Tacticus, the Byzantine general, who was kind of checking them out and see if they could pull anything off. And he runs away. He is also followed by a crusader who runs away. And he meets the Byzantine emperor with an enormous army who's coming to join with the Crusaders like they had agreed. And they tell him it's all lost. This entire enterprise is going to be completely defeated. And so, understanding that this is kind of the last army this emperor's got, he turns around and goes back into Constantinople, which means the Crusaders left to just do it all by themselves. It's very unfortunate if you're wishing the Crusaders victory, but that's what happens. And of course, the whole notion of the restoration of a Byzantine order and control in the area doesn't happen. We have the establishment of, from this over time, you have the establishment of crusading as an institution. You have things like the military orders. Some of you might have heard of the Templars. The Hospitallers still exist. They run very strong charitable organisation. The St John Ambulance is derived from these people, because the whole notion, particularly with the Hospitallers, with all of them with fighting, was not military conquest necessarily, but the assistance of others. And in those days, you couldn't help anybody if you couldn't defend them. So you have crusading as a as an institution. And there's the modern versions of them, the Queen and the head of the order. Okay, so any questions this far? And I'll get into some possible myths that we can talk about. I'll just check the time. Sorry, hopefully wasn't too quick. Any questions? Well, that's another debated question, but they think they're up to 8, maybe 9, 10. But the whole notion of crusade undergoes a bit of a development. There's kind of two types, if you want to put it that way. One is a particularly Jerusalem-focused endeavor that is about rescuing the Middle East, and particularly Palestine, and returning it to its ancient Christian control. Then there's the other notion, which is any act that is particularly called by the Pope, being the head of the church, to defend Christianity in some way or another. And it gets abused as well. It gets abused. Just like many good things, in my view, a crusade is a perfectly reasonable thing at the time, but many good things can get abused. But so you have crusades, waged against some of the Pope's, temporal enemies at the time, here and there over time. Of course, the whole notion of the crusade goes for, not a couple of hundred years. So there's plenty of different ways of doing it. The first crusade is the only one that conquered Jerusalem. It was the only one that actually managed to achieve that fundamental aim. One of the greatest, kind of the fundamental myth, and I'll call it a myth, that is predominant, is that the Crusades were wars of unprovoked aggression against a peaceful Muslim world. That's pretty much the kind of the feel you get in the media now, media in the past, that the Islamic world at the time was pretty peaceful, doing its own thing, and the bad Catholics came along and decided to knock them about, to use some Aussie terms. Now, hopefully, this very quick presentation, historical presentation, which I believe is entirely accurate, of course you can do your own research, manifests that's incorrect. And in fact, you could quite easily say that, since the rise of Islam until the fall of the Ottoman Empire, that the Western world has been under some form of heavy Islamic attack. So we're talking about right up until, if you want to be very technical, right up until the early 20th century. The Ottoman Empire being this phenomenally powerful and enormous empire that we kind of forget about because it fizzled out, just near World War One. But it's something that the Western world had to deal with constantly, up and down. Anybody have any other questions on this point? Not to make no dissenters in the audience?
Can I just make the point that at the time when Muhammad arose, in the 600s, there was the Roman Empire, there was so big that they had the East, which had converted to Christianity.
Mm.
Christianity became a state religion.
Yeah.
And it encompassed Europe, the Middle East, including Palestine, all of North Africa, which was not Arab at the time.
That's right.
Egypt were Egyptian.
Yep.
Libyans were not Arab.
That's right.
Algerians were not Arab. They had their own language, their own culture. So we had all that Mediterranean.
That's right.
It was Christian. And it became Christian relatively peaceful.
Mm-hmm.
It was part of the Roman Empire. The Roman Empire adopted Christianity.
Yeah.
Then you had these two big empires, the Byzantine Empire and the Persian Empire, with the superpowers at the time, fought each other to a standstill and became weak as a result of constant fighting. And out of nowhere, these Arabs, in Arabia, Saudi Arabia, conquered in very fast times, as you pointed earlier. And it wasn't a peaceful conquest. It was basically a bloody conquest.
Yeah, it was a conquest, yeah. It was a military conquest, yeah.
So people need to realise that what is now all Arab, North Africa, is not Arab.
Yeah, I think North Africa is one that is often forgotten because we're so used to what North Africa is, the last 100 years in our own kind of cultural memory. But North Africa was a very different place, in the Roman Empire, a very different place up until, a very distinctly different place up until the invasion of the Islamic armies at the time. Yeah, but thanks. Yeah. They were very, very strong culture, and it's, of course their rapid expansion is an example of that. It wasn't just 20 guys walking around; they're constantly gaining new followers. Of course, they divide up into their own unique cultures themselves within Islam as too. So you have the Moors, you have the Turks who aren't really that Arab at all as well, and they are thriving civilizations eventually as well in their own way. But the historical nature of the change is quite phenomenal and quite distinct. I'll get into this. Thank you for that. I'll get onto this point here, which is another one. The Crusaders were only interested in capturing booty and land. Their religious activities, well, you guys can read, were just a cover for greed and lust for wealth. Well, look, I don't know the motivation of every individual Crusader, but there has been a lot of historical research done on this. First, you have the very clear point from Pope Urban at the time, which was the idea of the Crusade is not to do this. The second point we have is the fact that crusading was and always was outrageously expensive. Very few enter into a crusading campaign or expedition thinking they're going to come out with more than what they left behind. And in fact, that's what practically happens to most of them. There is the notion of some of the Crusaders, and particularly the leaders were, and I'm talking about the First Crusade here, but this generally applies, but there's a couple of examples that it's not the case, but that they may have been granted large tracts of land in the Middle East to be the lord of, once they'd conquered that area. But that's not seeking power and wealth. These men who left for the Crusade, particularly the leaders, were all very wealthy, very powerful landowners. But in order to maintain the return of the Byzantine Empire, you actually need people to run the place. So there is that examples of that as well. For instance, those two Viking fellows were often considered to be the guys who just went out for booty and land, but there's recent discoveries in the seal documents in by historians that demonstrate that it's very likely that the Byzantine emperor wanted them to stay there and look after these places. You also have a lot of research done in the financial documents of crusaders before they left to go, and you find them loaning, taking out loans or selling off property in order to fund the adventure. So it's not considered necessarily to be a very watertight assertion that a crusader went off to get wealth and power. Yeah.
Isn't it true too that the leader of the crusade, the greatest one, was already well established lord of longer life than the
Romans? That's right.
And he took a vow to give up all his lands and never come back. He went off with his wife and all his people. He never came back.
That's right.
So
That's right. It's enormous, enormously powerful, wealthy man. Yeah. That's right. And if you look at, and this holds true, this kind of idea holds true throughout the Crusades, except for two or three possible examples I can think of. It's enormously expensive. There's a number of Crusaders that come back who are bankrupt, who go to prison because they've got no money. The fellow, Stephen LeBlanc, who ran away from Antioch, gets sent back by his wife because it's a shame. He dies, of course. But there are examples, you know, of the abuse of the Crusades, particularly, say, by the Venetians in the Fourth Crusade, when the Fourth Crusade got diverted to Constantinople. We can talk about that. I'm not so much of an expert on that. But, or perhaps some you know, bad notions of Crusades in Northern Europe could be argued as being, well, they're out after land and power. But the fundamental idea of the Crusades was not this. And there's no historical evidence to make it a worthwhile claim whatsoever. And this is a follow-on. This is a great furphy, this one, which comes from a variety of ideas. Stephen Runciman is a very well-known historian, quite an old one, who had this idea, but it's been proven incorrect. The idea that you've got all these younger sons of nobles who are trained to be soldiers going around causing trouble. Well, let's just get all them together and push them over to Muslim lands to spend their time doing that. That's not the case. Now, of course, there were some landless nobles who went on a crusade, but the Crusaders were led by very, very wealthy, very powerful dukes and princes of the time. It was not just a couple of landless, land-greedy soldiers going off to cause some trouble. The Pope used the Crusaders to gain control of the Church and of Rome, another version of this whole idea, because during the Middle Ages and even a little bit outside the Middle Ages, you often had different competing claimants to the papal throne. You have anti-popes and popes. Urban II at the time did not have control of Rome. Did not at all. But the Crusaders travel to Rome. They make pilgrimage to Rome on the way. And they never turn to attack Rome and conquer it for the Pope. They do defend, they do kind of give him a guard during some of them give the Pope a guard during part of their trip in Italy, but that's about it. Now, this is a period without police. Now, just imagine that, there's no police. You're getting beaten up, you can't call the police. You need to have soldiers to protect you. So this is another one of those furphies that is not correct. The Crusaders wanted to convert Muslims to Christianity. Well, that's not true. There's no historical evidence of that. There's no nothing in any of the documentation we have on the purpose of the Crusade, from the papacy, from the soldiers, that the idea is to go and convert these Muslims to Christianity. Now, maybe some of them did convert. Overwhelming stories of mass conversion. In fact, in the areas that Christians reconquered, which of course didn't last very long, Muslims and Christians worshipped fairly freely. To be honest, that was also the case in Muslim lands in some places, but it wasn't that wasn't particularly well known in those places. But The fundamental idea is that the Crusades were not wars of conversion. The idea wasn't you go on a crusade to China to convert. Crusades were wars, and war at the time was one of the only ways you could achieve this kind of change. Were wars of reconquest, of reclaiming, and defending, and particularly defending. Now, check the time again. Oh, we're doing all right. I should have gone a bit longer. Okay. Now this is a big one, and I'm not going to start defending massacring people, but I want to give the context here to this event. Firstly, there were not enough people living in the city to enable blood to flow ankle deep. It's not possible. So we have great poetic license here. There were a large number of crusaders who did not take part in the sack of the city. What's really important to understand here is three things. I'll say three things, I'll give you five probably, but three things. One is the whole custom and military tradition of siege and sack. Two is the Crusaders' experience of Antioch. And three is one I've forgotten, so hopefully I'll remember three once we get there. I said I'd do five. But, okay, so siege and sack. Now, anyone have any understand of that notion? Yeah? Okay, well, yes and no. So the medieval understanding of warfare had a particular set of laws and honour and things like that. You couldn't go to war unless you had a justification for it. Now, a lot of them would go anyway, but you couldn't have a law against without a justification. If you lay siege to a city, you don't just attack. You give it a chance to surrender, to respond. There's a great scene in Henry V by Shakespeare where they're besieging Harfleur, and Shakespeare says to the mayor of the town, "Will you yield and this sack avoid, or guilty in defence be thus destroyed?" So the idea was, here's the army, you can see what we've got. If we attack the city, we can't control everybody when they come in, our soldiers when they come in. So you have a chance to surrender and have terms. If you decide, no, we're going to gamble, we're going to defend ourselves, well, we can't, you know, it's a whole different story. Now, that doesn't sound very nice, but you're dealing in war here. It's better than what you could often get stuck with. And the Crusaders actually follow this practice, particularly the Siege of Nicaea. They besiege Nicaea. Nicaea surrenders to the Byzantines. They don't sack the city, even though they've got hardly any money left. They're running out of food already. They don't sack the city. What happens in Jerusalem is quite the opposite. And they spend a lot of time just going around the city, talking to the Fatimids who are in there, and they pretty much thumb their nose at them. Now, the reason, we'll go to the second point, the reason the Fatimids thumbed their nose at them, and actually there's stories that actually did that to them, was that they knew that they would get rescued from Egypt. That a large army would come from Egypt to rescue them, and an army did turn up just a bit too late. So the Crusaders had an experience in Antioch of almost being wiped out by conquering a city, then all of a sudden having an army around them, besieging them, plus the inhabitants of the city also at war with them as well. So you also have here a very unfortunate and disgusting atrocity that is taking place not just purely out of wanton desire for blood, that there is some form of rationale behind the madness which is war. The Battle of Ascalon happens not so long after, that's the third point I forgot, the Battle of Ascalon happens not so long after the Siege of Jerusalem, where an enormous army is eventually defeated by the Crusaders, but that army was coming to besiege the Crusaders in Jerusalem. Any questions on that? Do I sound like I'm trying to make a silk purse out of a sow's ear in this regard? But I think there's context to this, which we often don't hear. I might end with this one. It's another version of it, but there is a great intellectual exercise in looking at, well, how does our modern view of the Crusades come about? because of course the Crusaders themselves didn't think they were medieval colonialists. There's a whole variety of reasons, but it comes out of strong anti-Catholic propaganda from particularly Enlightenment thinkers in France, but also the anti-Catholic thinking from Protestantism in England. But then you get, so there's a lot of, you know, desire to paint the Crusades in a bad light. But then you have the whole notion of colonialism as a good thing. And of course, the Crusades are a great example of the West bringing enlightenment to the East, and then colonialism becomes a bad thing again, and of course the Crusades are a bad thing. The whole actual story is lost entirely. But that's how we get to kind of a historical, intellectual history of how we get to the modern idea of what crusading is, and the Crusades were. I might leave it there. There's a whole variety of things to go. Any questions? Yes. Yeah, look, that's a constant too. And in fact, there's a lot of pre-crusading, if you want to call it, where soldiers come from Europe to defend Spain. Spain, essentially, the Christians in Spain have this amazing story of being in constant war and in constant peace as well, with as you know, 900 years goes past, with Moorish armies and Moorish kingdoms in Spain. But yes, there was. It was consistently that kind of thing. But the call for the Crusades proper, as we know them, came from a request for help from the Byzantine emperor. Yeah. Any other questions?